I'm going to say welcome everybody here to an episode of Talk Dota, which is something which I have not had to say, Maelk, in about a year.
Aren't you glad?
No, I really miss this show, man.
No, I mean, aren't you glad that you get to say it?
Oh, yeah, I'm really glad I get to say it. It's one of these things which we hoped we'd always bring back, and it's taken us this long to actually not bring it back properly. Instead, we're doing a special episode. This is also the most amount of talking I'm probably going to do, like the largest amount of talking I'm going to do all night. We're doing the gameplay update for 6.80, which came out recently through the Dota 2 patch. It's not officially in the client just yet, but it got released out last night. So we said, you know what, let's get together a band of people that are happy to talk about things and actually have something interesting to say. So we have sitting on my side here in the studio, he's the new manager of joinDOTA. He's formerly of, well, we should say MYM. I think that's going to be the first team that everybody thinks of when they think of you. Competing at TI1, he hung up a flag at TI2.
And that's as far as I got.
Yeah, that was basically all he really did there. Was on the panel of TI3 with Malini, Bruno, as well as James. We have also with us, we can say we're sitting on that side, we have syndereN, also tagged up as feederen. He is coach, he is streamer, and he is formerly of every team that normally has to have a stand-in. But it is syndereN, also an old friend who loves, we always love casting with syndereN. So it's great to have him back on the show. And of course, he was one of the original hosts. It was myself, Puppy, as well as syndereN. But of course, you know, when we were replacing Puppy, like, we already had you come in, and really, you're not enough to replace Puppy.
I'm really not. I don't think anyone is enough to replace Puppy. And it needs to be said, we did want Puppy.
We did.
Puppy did not want us.
That's pushing
it hard.
Maybe not fully the case, but...
he didn't have time.
He didn't have time tonight. So instead, we decided to get two extra professionals, and we bring in a guy who is very famous for his blog posts and also for success under the captain's tag. Also, the fellow old teammate. Didn't actually kind of realize this when we put him together. But these guys used to play together, and now he's in fact in Team Sigma, and... syndereN's and Team syndereN, but it is going to be Bucking Mad. I censor his name. I don't think I'm the only person that does it. It's Fucking Mad. This is the casual. This is talkDOTA. We can say his name is Fucking Mad.
I read his AMA saying that he would change to 7 Mad, perhaps, mayhaps, if needed.
If I'm forced one day, but that's actually one of the first time we have Fucking Mad and not Bucking Mad on a joinDOTA stream. So that's a
yeah,
that's the first time. That's great.
Do you always worry, like, the world censors you too much?
No, it's completely fine. Actually, I think Bucking Mad pretty much, you know, it's almost the same as Fucking Mad right now. Lots of people call me Bucking Mad, and they don't have any kinds of censor. It's like, you know, in live in the tournament or anything. So it's fine. I'm getting used to it.
Awesome. Well, we're not here to do a bit of a catch-up session. We can do that at some other time. This is at least the straight-in, hard business kind of talkDOTA with 6.80. And this is the time when I step back. I'll direct points of conversation that we want to say. If you guys have something too which you want to bring up, put it in the chat. I got a couple of things pulled in from people who posted over on Reddit, people who posted up on the joinDOTA news article as well that said talkDOTA was coming back, and also a couple of professional players. I asked around today, and I've got a couple of points that's come out from a couple of the guys around the scene, and we've managed to stretch down to Southeast Asia for a couple of these opinions, and up to America, and all through Europe as well. So I'm interested to see all three of your thoughts on this one. I am going to have little to no opinions during this because that's the way people like it.
We don't like your opinion, Toby.
Yeah. No one ever did. No one ever did. So,
all right, let's get to it.
Yeah, all right, let's get into it. So the first things which I have, and I'm gonna start off right now with a player opinion. I don't want to go through bit by bit. I want to take the key things which matter to us and matter to the people who I've also been talking to as well. I don't want to go through dot point by dot point by dot point because then I kind of feel like we've run a marathon at the end of it. So I want to start off talking about a hero. Now, this is a quote coming out from S4, and it basically said this Ven armor buff will make him a beast during the laning phase. Now, I know we're not starting with a controversial topic, unless you guys think it is. But right now, I actually want to start with you, Matt, on this one. What do you think about the changes to Sven? How do you think they're going to impact us all?
I think it will impact the hero for sure. I mean, you know, in especially in Sigma, but myself and my team, and like we're a lot focused on hero stats. We think it's very important, and it makes a very big difference. That's one of the reasons why we favor Bane that much, because he's just naturally tanky, and that's something you can use early on to great asset. I think it would be the same with Sven. Basically, Warcry is already a very underrated spell, in my opinion, but like the laning phase of Sven has always been really weak. It will still be. I mean, he's in, like, to a certain extent, he can be aggressive, but just to set up, you know, chain stuns and stuff like this, but he can't really kill people on his own. I don't think so, at least. Like, this armor buff will make it really hard to face a Sven Trident, but it doesn't fix the problem. It's, I mean, it won't change a lot. It will make him viable, I think, especially in 3 versus 3 situation. But beside that, I don't think it changes the hero that much. The Warcry buff is interesting as well, to be honest.
Well, syndereN, do you agree, disagree?
Yeah, pretty much. I think the statement from S4 is a little bit of an overreaction, but I get where he's coming from, because also, like Matt says, if you're playing a melee hero in any sort of lane, you're always going to have the range disadvantage because you're melee. But with this kind of armor, you can actually get in quite well. I'm not completely sure what Sven's base HP is, because of course armor gets really interesting if you have such a significant amount of health that the spells don't take out too much of your health, and then suddenly the armor is really important. I don't think it's going to make him a beast. I think it's going to make him quite a bit better in the lane. But still, I'm not completely sure what S4 meant, if he meant for a particular laning scenario or just in general. But I feel like to play Sven properly, you kind of have to play him in a farming trial lane, right?
To give a little bit more like reference behind of what he actually said, because when I was talking to him, he was bringing up a whole lot of things. Like, you ask a pro player one opinion and he gives you five. And one of the things he was talking about is Sven getting really strong in the lane. But he was also talking about like a combination you would then do with the Wisp bottle. Now, this takes us into a different kind of area when we start talking about this, because the bottle, in fact, got itself a rework. So this can now be used on your allies by holding down the control key, which basically said that he said you can't really kill an aggressive tri-lane with the Wisp kind of thing, was the impression I was getting from him. So do you think, like, if we're going to bring the bottle into the whole scenario now, combining it with its Sven changes, do you think this changes the aggressive tri lane?
Once again, I still feel like what carries that lane is not necessarily the change in armor for Sven, but it's the other things then. It's the fact that you're with an IO, which has always, in my opinion, been a strong combo. Of course, 3 armor makes a difference and makes it even stronger, so I mean, it's a no-brainer. He only received buffs, so of course he's better, but I still feel like the statement is kind of an exaggeration. Because, as Matt also pointed out, Sven still has the same problems. He's just a little tankier in the lane. I don't think this brings him back on any sort of top of the list, but he, of course, it's nice to see him, but I don't think this is one of the biggest changes in the patch, to be honest.
No, it's not for sure. One thing it gives to Sven, though, it's the ability to dive, I guess. I mean, maybe roaming Sven is more efficient. Like, when you get 3 armor buff, it's quite a lot. You can tank tower early on, especially first level. Like, he has a very good stun, very reliable one, so it sets up perfectly to four heroes, like, I don't know, like Invoker, Sunstrike and stuff like this. So maybe there's something to do with the roaming Sven and like playing more aggressive on an offensive tri lane, being able, like, the Warcry basically gives you a lot of tanking potential for you and your supports if you want to dive towers and stuff like this. So yeah, I guess being able to play Sven more aggressively in early game, but doesn't change anything to the hero later on. As Sin said, I think it's not one of the major changes. It's good to see Sven kind of back in the game, but I don't think it will make him a top pick or anything like this. That's my prediction, at least.
I think this is a case of a lot of small buffs adding up to Sven actually being viable. Not only does he receive buffs himself, we also see Blink Dagger mana cost removed. Not that a lot of Svens went for Blink Dagger, but now it's actually an option to go for an early game Blink Dagger. On top of that, Mask of Madness received a little buff, like 3% lifesteal, but it all adds up. And then, as you were saying with the bottle chains, that Wisp can suddenly, like, or all supports for that matter, can go for a bottle and heal up in the laning stage. All these little things may play in to Sven suddenly being viable again. And I mean, a year ago, he was far and away one of the best picks in combination with Wisp, and we saw teams like EG, for instance, who had a lot of success with Sven in the limited success they had.
Hurts you to say that, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
Nice. In a sense, I still just feel like that this armor is all good, but like you say, the IO Sven combo, I still think that's still incredibly strong. I think teams just for sometimes there's kind of no reason, sometimes there's a good reason, but it's just kind of fallen out of favor. And what's interesting to see is when there's these patches where there is some sort of buff, people just remember the hero again and the combos because they've just forgotten about how useful it is. So this armor buff could have been one, and maybe it would make the same difference to how what kind of priority he gets.
Just before we transition into our next point, guys, could you guys both check your Skype levels and make sure your microphones aren't auto-correcting? I'm saying that because a lot of people are saying they're hearing rain, and it's because, when your microphone doesn't make sound for a while, it tries to correct it on Skype. So just tools, options, sound settings, and check that, and make sure it's not auto-adjusting. And while you guys are doing that, I'm going to bring up a public point. I'm doing this for the people at home who have been sitting there in all pick mode playing ranked matches and just like gritting their teeth at every single person that waits until even the creep wave spawns up before they get their pick so they can counter pick you. I'm so glad that Valve has noticed this and has changed this. Because it was mad that screwed it up. Yeah, perfect. Thank you for changing that. Thank you for changing that. Have you guys, like either three of you guys, all three of you guys, been a victim of the not picking in AP ranked mode?
Oh yeah, I was.
I know I was once in Southeast Asia.
Question is there ever a game when it doesn't happen? I feel like,
well,
until
it's,
now.
It's now going to be a lot harder, as I'm bringing up the change log up on the screen. So now you lose one gold per second if you haven't picked up a hero after the selection timer runs out. Which is great. Like, for all those people that also go AFK, if they go AFK during the pick phase, they'll be completely out of money. So either it's going to see an increasing amount of pauses coming out, or people sacrifice their gold to get a counter pick.
I mean, it's not that much gold.
And you're at one a second? I suppose, yeah, you'd have to wait, like, well, 5-6 minutes until you're out of it completely.
And mind you, the selection timer has increased, so...
True.
Yeah. And if you think about it, in terms of if you have a hero and you repick, how much gold does that cost again? Is it 150? So that would be the same as being AFK for 2.5 minutes in the pick and all pick. So, I don't know. Like, it does matter. And the most important thing about this is that people who wait too long get punished. I don't feel like there's too much to analyze here, though. It's kind of obvious what it's trying to do and what it will do. I still think some people might want to sacrifice a bit of gold to get the right pick, though. So it's still about the player type. But at least now they have to pay. That's the important part.
Yeah. We also now realize, too, that it's syndereN's microphone, but it seems he's muting and unmuting himself when he's talking, so that works for us. I suppose we should get the last general point out of the way before we like start bouncing around through the heroes.
Yeah.
Roshan changes. Now, obviously, this has kind of gone. It's going to influence the game a crap ton more. You got no longer stops upgrading his HP and damage after 45 minutes. I'm wondering if this is now going to limit our late game Roshans. But more importantly, like, Roshan upgrade rate is increased by 20%. I know, I think it was RK I was talking to. In fact, I think I actually have a quote from him here before I forget it. And it is, I would say Roshan is good, but he is stronger, faster into the game. So you can't just win one fight and then take a quick Rosh to get ahead. That was his...
It actually depends on the heroes you have, I guess. Makes it harder for sure. I mean, I would agree with his point, but... You know, it's still like a Roshan lineup will be able to do Rosh. If they could do Rosh level 1, like, they're going to be able to do Rosh at 20 minute mark, you know, with the new changes anyway, of course.
Yeah, it's no... I don't foresee a major change in this. It's going to be less of the soloing Rosh
that we've
seen a lot of heroes do. There's no change, like, the way Bug and Matt wished for a level 1 Roshan change, so that wouldn't happen. I think that was one of his biggest wishes this year.
Yeah, true.
There's a lot of time left in the year still. Maybe it happens later on.
Can't see
I actually think the biggest Roshan change, to be honest, is the bounty rescaling. I think that's more important than the upgrade rate. I guess there's going to be quite some people disagreeing with me on that, but like you guys said, he's still a really easy kill. it's a little hard for me to completely imagine how much this 20% upgrade rate really does, but I think it's nice to have the bounty rescale, because if you look at the old values, how randomly lucky you could actually get with the Roshan last kill. 105 to 600 gold is now 150 to 400, so we're still keeping the Dota way of having a bit of random factors like we do in creep gold and tower gold, etc., but now it's not these kind of gaps. I think this was a too big gap that you could get 600. So I really like this change. I think it's good to normalize that a bit. But I still think even with this change, people are really happy about it. I think it's not enough, to be honest, but we're going to see. But I'm not really overwhelmed by this in any way.
What issue are you overwhelmed by, Sinkers? I know I asked both of you guys to like go away, think of some points before we came in tonight. What's one of the first things that you would want to bring up to people's attention looking at this change log?
I want to say goodbye to Alchemist. see you in 10 versions, man.
It seems Matt's taking your thunder now. We're going on Alchemist. We're going on Alchemist, syndereN. Sorry, you've been shut down.
It's cool. I was going to bring the same one up, to be honest. So he can go with it. It's cool.
It's like, that's such a huge nerf to Alchemist. I mean, a needed one for sure, but definitely a big nerf. And I don't think, of course, he's going to be picked, like, still, maybe. I don't know. If it was only me, I wouldn't pick anymore at all. I think other heroes are way more interesting. And like the point Sin made a bit earlier is really right, in my opinion. You know, the changes with every patch are not only about those changes. They're about reminding people that hero is really viable. That one, like, is really, how to say, overused. So, I mean, of course, this pack is going to impact the metagame. One of the big changes would be Alchemist. He was top pick, like first pick or first ban in any kind of game. For any team, I think, like, whether it is the Western or the Eastern ones, so that's a very big change, in my opinion.
Maelk, any opinions or agree?
I agree with Bucking Matt, he's a clever guy. I'll just be the excessive.
Are you turning into a yes man now in your management days?
No, it'll come. I'm sure down the list I'll disagree with half of what people have to say.
All right. Well, let's go for one thing which I think people might either massively agree with or massively disagree with, and that's Jakiro. Jakiro is where I'm heading next, and reason for this one: this call comes out from the Power Rangers. In fact, from FNG, and he says I like Jakiro a lot, and I think he is usable now in a lot of lineups. He doesn't even need a teamfight combo; just one stun and Jakiro can deal a lot of damage. Something like a DK Jakiro combination.
A DJ Jakiro,
yeah, yeah. Well, two heads, two desks. Maelk, thoughts?
I think I think Icepath was one of his best spells, but obviously not from the damage. So this is a sort of a huge buff in my book. But he was already he already had this buff, 8 months ago, something like that, where Liquid Fire was improved.
And yeah, Liquid Fire became castable as opposed to just being a passive.
Yeah. And I mean, I've never been a big fan of dual breath, and especially not the damage over time on it. But it is a pretty significant buff. I mean, the impact damage is gone, but in turns the DPS is really, really increased by a lot. So a pretty decent buff, I'd say. It's definitely... I think it's an attempt to make dual breath and liquid fire as viable as ice path.
Matt, do you think you'll be picking up anytime soon?
I really love that hero. Like, I'm one of the defenders of the Dark Sphere THD combo. It's such an insane combo that's underused. I mean, I still recall that like Navi was the specialist of that one. Like the Puppy Funny combo or Puppy Light of Heaven, whoever played Darcer back then with them. It's such an easy combo. Like the Ice Pass is one of the best spells in this game, in my opinion. Like you can a good Ice Pass, first of all, it's pretty easy to land. It's really, really big AoE and it stays for like a second or so. And it can just turn a fight. So I would agree with Mike. I think THG, like it's about the Ice Pass, at least that's the way I see it. Yeah, now it's kind of a big buff. This hero is definitely viable. I think it's really strong. It's a bit slow, and again, like Dota is so focused on the laning phase right now that, of course, it's not really about his teamfight ability, more about his laning phase. That's the way I see it, at least. Maybe we can see some solo THG. The Liquid Fire, it's a really strong spell, honestly. Like, for example, THG solo mid has always been really viable. Like, it's a really, really strong one. He's also insanely good at killing Roshan. And any kind of tower, of course. I don't think... of course, it's okay, but Dual Breath, for me, is like his least interesting spell. So, I need to see it in action.
And what this buff, or whatever it is lacking is the fact that damage over time is just not really as good as burst damage. Like, you want burst damage, especially at a competitive level, so it doesn't really change anything in the way he's going to be picked on a competitive level at all.
Definitely.
Yep. That was actually what I wanted to point out, because I was about to say I'll be the odd one out and I'll disagree with you guys thinking Dual Breath is buffed, because I'm actually not so sure about it, to be honest. It's reworked, so it's better in different scenarios now. But if this is, I think it's really hard to say if it's a buff or a nerf overall.
I think because the buff this is depends in the fact that the slow is bigger. Like,
First
of all, the later stages of the DPS is higher, but also the slow is a bit more. So I think it's definitely a buff. It's just not a worthwhile buff.
But it's a buff in a particular part of the game. That's the whole point. Because, like you said, in most scenarios in competitive games, you would like to have burst damage on your spells. And when you reach the mid game, Dual Breath could make a big difference if a hero was stunned, for example. But if there is something like a BKB and you're hexed, for example, and then you get out and then you get to pop your BKB, the fact that the damage is applied over such a long time and the burst factor is gone doesn't mean too much in a laning stage, but it means quite a lot in the mid game when you start taking team fights, which are a lot about getting the really good initiation and the burst, like you said. And that's kind of gone, so... I don't know, I feel like, once again, this is a change that is... I think the Ice Path, like you said, is the bigger buff, that it's 50 on level 1, that's kind of nice. But... I don't feel like this makes Dual Breath much better, to be completely honest.
It's going to help him to force back offlaners on a one-on-one scenario, you know, when you're playing him safe lane and you have to force back, you know, they're really hard offlaners you have to deal with nowadays with, like, Super, so maybe that's something.
But the total damage is still kind of the same. It's actually worse on level 1.
Mm-hmm.
It gets 10 more damage on level 3 and 20 more damage on level 4 in total. It's like nothing, so...
I was looking at, you know, the slow duration and the burn duration, like...
Yeah. It helps a little, but it's really not that big of a deal.
Well, for sure. It's really not a big deal. I would agree.
I want to go on to something now, which is, like, I got sparked because you guys are talking about laning phase, talking about, like. I want to talk about the AoE fights. I want to talk about the transition for this one. And there's two heroes I want to bring up when we start this conversation. And they may not be the two heroes you guys think of, and I'd like to see if you think of any other heroes which you really think is going to be like the big ones. You can say it in a moment, but let's get through my two heroes to start with. First one I want to bring up is Lion.
I knew it.
First one I'm going to bring up is Lion. Speaking as the man who was preaching that solo mid Lion should come back. X, you live again, as a mid solo, if you'd ever do that again. and the other thing is just Enigma, because I can, because the radius is now a little bit bigger. Start with syndereN on this one, because Maelk has an opinion, so I want to go to syndereN. Aghanim Scepter upgrade. Now is a 200 AoE on the primary target.
Yeah. Again, this is one of those things where I feel like people overreact. What was the last Aghanim change where we had overreactions? It was Omni Knight, where I personally thought that was going to be incredible. We still haven't seen it in a single game.
What change was that?
His ultimate is global? With Aghanim. And it hits buildings, so they get invulnerable too.
I forgot about that.
that hasn't been used. I was like, wow, this is really incredible, and nobody uses it, so I don't know. But there was another Aghanim's change as well, where people were hyped. The Doom Aghanim's, where people were like, wow, this is amazing. I was like, this is terrible. Why would you ever build that item?
I mean, it saw a bit of play.
It did, but like, it's kind of a
like
niche thing.
Race car Doom build, where he would just run people down.
At which one you wouldn't need Doom to kill them if you had that race car build.
Yeah, you just run in circles around him and be like, haha, he'd be like one giant bully.
The reason I like this Lion thing is that it's cool for gimmicky plays, and it's going to make some big plays every once in a while. But if you want to make a strategy built around getting people pulled together so you can finger of death them, that's kind of, you know, the kind of skill and the kind of timing and the kind of mistakes from the enemy team required to pull this off is kind of... There's a lot of other things you could use together with that. I think the only combo that really comes to mind is Lion together with Magnus, because Magnus is kind of easy to land on two, maybe three targets, then it's strong. But apart from that, I don't see there's not that many situations in the game where heroes are so close to each other. 200 AoE is really very little.
I think Matt's got another opinion on that one.
I want to see some Dark Souls like vacuum finger of death.
Yeah, it's hard.
I want to see like Lion, you know, like vacuum, like impale and finger of death. I want to see this move at least once. It's gonna happen for sure. It also bursts Lion's ability to farm, I guess. I mean, no, honestly, like if you max mana drain, you go for the full mana drain, and you like, what's the cooldown on this? It's 20 seconds, right? Like with Aghanim's, so you have a 20 seconds cooldown.
Well, that's your
E spell. I like that. That's thinking outside the box. I really like that one. He has a valid point. Like you can clear a creep wave every time. Like what are
you? Wait, so you end up stacking for a Lion to finger of death?
No,
you mana drain the range creep, clear the wave, and go for the next wave, 20 seconds. You have the next wave as well. Just Lion pushing lanes, and then Lion full item slots when you have Aghanim's.
That is what Queen of Pains used to do. Like, they would rush a Ganon Scepter, and it would have a 30-second cooldown on the Sonic Wave, and you would just run up, clear a creep wave.
Queen has no mana drain, you know? So she runs out of mana, Lion doesn't. Let's go for the Lion carry mode.
That's actually really cool that you point that out, Maelk, because if you check out the Queen of Pain change, that's kind of what it is now. It's 40 seconds on all levels with the Aghanim's now. It's kind of a big deal.
Yeah.
So let's not go to that yet.
You don't want to go to that one yet?
You wanted Enigma first, right?
Oh, we can do this one.
We can do this. We can get to Enigma.
It's, okay. It's a bridge.
It's, right. Remember, it's very like casual. Very casual. But yeah, so 40 seconds. Change on Queen of Pain. Are we really turning into like ultimate farming? Because this, for me, starts to feel like a couple of the LoL games I played.
No, it's not just farming. I mean, it's prioritizing an Aghanim Scepter is something you want to do early on in the game, where it's still beneficial to you, because later on you need much bigger items, much more worthwhile items. But having the Aghanim Scepter early on is going to add you that HP and mana pool that you so desperately need on an intelligence hero such as Queen of Pain. So getting her cooldown reduced early on is definitely an improvement. I'm not going to say it's going to mean anything to her being picked more often. I don't think it will, but it's definitely a nice change, especially for a public player such as myself now.
It means you'll have it in every gank. That's kind of what's cool about it. When you have the Ag Scepter, you can really just gank with ulti all the time. And previously you would have it like, oh, now I used my ulti, now I have to wait. No, you don't. You just immediately heal up with your bottle with a rune or by going to base, and then you can gank with your ult again. It's kind of cool, actually. I like it.
To be honest, like my opinion about the problem with Aghanim Scepter in competitive games is that when you build an Aghanim Scepter, then you're not getting BKB or Orchids or really key items that you need in some games. You know, like getting that extra silence, that extra magic immunity that can win you games. You know, Aghanim does nothing. I mean, it gets you more tanky. Of course, you get. If you're not able to put your ultimate as a Queen of Pain because you're getting disabled, or, you know, I feel like Aghanim Scepter is I don't want to say a weak item, but it doesn't bring as much as other items, even with this kind of buff, you know.
I think it's
very situational.
It's a small item. Like,
yeah, it is, for sure.
You really got to dominate the game, and if you do, then this is just going to further help you dominate said game.
Yeah. But it's that situational that this type of change won't make it a top item for this kind of hero, in my opinion. You still, as a Queen of Pain, you still need something else, I feel.
All right, let's move to Enigma.
Yeah.
Now, Matt,
this is Enigma.
I can kind of say that all three of you are all known Enigma players.
In different ways.
Yeah.
I was so inspired by Maelk.
Sin was mid. Mad was five man black hole, doesn't matter where he played it.
Well, what are you gonna say I was then?
Well, you're a 0/20 man.
Well, that's still a Venomance, and this is.
it's a sacrifice yourself, hero.
Christ.
Yeah, so it's perfectly down your alley. Yeah, but is it any kind of like. It's not even a large enough change for it to come back. Like, it's 25 range on the cast, as well as like 25 area of effect. Is that really enough to make Enigma worth it?
It's still picked already. It gets picked every now and then when you can afford to go for a greedy jungler, I feel.
Exactly. So. But that's the key, what you said. When you can afford to go for a greedy jungler, and it doesn't change it at all. So, it's. I mean, I guess PGG is going to get people in his black hole now. I'm just kidding.
It's very good your face froze when you were saying that. Yeah. Wonderful.
That's a joke I have. Like, PGG, the best Enigma player, obviously. No, you know, his ultimate is still very strong. It's going to be easier to land it, obviously, but doesn't change Enigma's problem, his laning potential, you know?
Yeah. I think Puppy... I'm pretty sure it was Puppy who used to say, you don't pick Enigma for the black hole. And yeah. I would still... I'm not completely agreeing with that, but I get his point. Like, you pick Enigma because it's really nice to have a fast mech carrier who can get it in the jungle, who can push with conversions, and then you have a single target stun in ganks. And then black hole is like the... If you land it, it's amazing, but you can't rely a team composition around hitting a black hole. And that's still the case. Like Matt said, it still has the same problems. It's nice to see a little bit of a buff, but I don't think this really... This doesn't change as much as many other things in the version, to be honest.
Any other big heroes which you think are now going to be like the AoE? I know we discussed Magnus very, very shortly, but base intelligence increased by 2 is not really something to write home about. Is
it
there anybody,
a bit too
anybody
like
else?
Laning phase on the middle lane, but aside from that, it's not a big thing. I can see Matt have something he wants to say.
Yeah, Matt?
I do. The Lycan, man. The Lycan. Like the hero, the forgotten hero that I want back in the metagame for such a long time. And that doesn't come back for some reason. I mean, since this world, like the big nerf on his summons, to make them really weak against physical damage. No, like the fate time, the invisibility, like, honestly, the buff is quite decent in my opinion. I'm pretty sure they can be used for something else right now. I would like to see him come back. I think he's still viable.
Would you still put him as a core hero? Like, obviously, you can't jungle him with the wolves getting that type of buff. But would you run him? And I hate to quote Speed Gaming here because I do it enough times. But would you try and do it like Eternal Envy tries to do it, which is top lane solo, example Dire side, and then you let like an aggressive trial lane run on the bottom and just give the Lycan space up on top? Or would you go more black style and then try and keep it safe lane and protected by supports?
Anywhere, I would even run him jungle. Like I tried him jungle many times and he's still completely viable jungle. Just about the right anti and build at the right timings, but he can farm really fast in the jungle. This buff on the wolves, it's two things. You can just farm without Vladimir's now, in my opinion. The 15 HP regen is quite huge, and he's gonna be such a pain in the ass for the supports. Like I think whenever you have those wolves that are just running around, level 5 you can already scout basically everywhere with it. You can just place them. It's gonna be like invisible wards. They have really good vision. And if you're able to do this level 5, I think it's like I see a lot of potential with this new new buff on the Lycan.
You want to lane him? Is that how?
I mean,
if you're level 5 and you're jungling, you're probably not going to send them out to scout, right?
Yeah, that's true. I mean, the problem is that if you lane him, then you're maybe not maxing walls, or I'm not sure about this. I think Lycan safe lane is really good. One on one, not that much. He's kind of weak one on one. It depends on against which heroes, but generally he's weak. I think he loses his matchup. But for example, Lycan safe lane with supports that can give, you know, extra on a 2-1-2 setup, or he's really good on a 2-1-2 setup, to be honest. If you're gonna play a double offensive with the help of his passive, then it's really and there's the old school, you know, Lycan safe lane with SF mid using a whole level 1 to get SF all the last hits and SF just crushing his 1-on-1. That's also something that can be used and that's not used at all in DOTA, in competitive DOTA nowadays.
Okay, I have a few heroes. Are we going to go through all the heroes? Or
no, we're going through the heroes which interest us.
Oh, okay. I have a few. First of all, Sniper. The addition to his range is, like, believe, almost insane.
Like, it's his base range again.
It's a pretty big buff.
So God, he has 950 range.
Take aim range bonus increased from 80, 162, 43, 22, 100, 200, 300, 400. So you get 80 at the maximum.
Like, this guy's gonna, like, at nighttime, is he gonna stand in fog and hit you and you don't know, like, is it gonna be like that?
But see, the nighttime vision is 800, right?
Yeah.
And now he has 950. So in the previous version, you actually could
outrange
it. But I think this is crazy, but it. it's again, it's buffing Sniper on what he's already good at, which is something that often works out really well, but he still has exactly the same problem as always. He can't farm so fast, and he's really weak in lane. So, I don't know. I guess the extra little bit of range in the start can help, but when it really starts scaling and gets relevant, that's kind of... Then Sniper already got past his worst phase in the game, I feel.
I'm just afraid on the middle lane that he's going to be like a such
on mid, it's true.
Force that
yeah.
You can't put anything against him there. Like, imagine even an OD, like a...
Yeah, that's
one
true.
One of the strongest one-on-one laners on the middle lane, right? How is he ever going to get an Astral Imprisonment?
He'll never reach him.
He'll never reach him. He's just going to take headshots constantly. I feel this is going to be a huge issue where, like, you go back to the olden days of Dota 1 where you had, like, Viper. Nothing could stand against it.
Yeah, I think you're right. Sniper is kind of the best one-on-one hero if he maxes take aim now, because nothing can touch him. That's true. But still, do you really want to put a Sniper mid? What's your payback, unless if he gets really good farm? He can't really perform the classic mid lane functions. He's not a good mech carrier, he's not a good controller, he doesn't push so well.
Just wait and see when Alliance brings out their Ogre lineups where they gank a ton and just have Sniper farming up.
That's
on
true,
Ogre.
He's cool
this
with
is
Ogre.
Gonna happen. I mean, they're gonna do like Ogre and Lina and run around with smokes and gank everyone, and then eventually Loda's gonna have the farm and he's just gonna...
Well, who knows, it could even be Admiral Bulldog's new hero if you're gonna run him on a safe lane for that kind of thing. I'm not talking offlane. I'm talking like if you're putting an aggressive tri lane, you put him on the safe lane. Sure, you could leave Loader up there because he loves Sniper, but like if you've got that range and you're still looking for a 1v1 matchup, would we entertain the idea of offlane?
No.
No.
No, I wouldn't.
You wouldn't?
No.
He's still slow and vulnerable and.
So he has to basically be hugging a tower at all times.
Yeah, it'll like if you ever put him offlane, it's because you rely on your enemy being dumb as all hell.
Pretty much. Yeah. I think so too.
All right. This is the reason why I don't have an opinion. So what was some of your other ones?
I wanted to like hear their opinion on Pandaren Brewmaster's.
Yeah.
Well, I've actually got one to share about that.
Nice.
And because I know someone told me something about Panda and Brewmaster.
Well, let's hear what they
here it is. Oh, it actually came from Exist. Basically said Brewmaster is back to mid. This is Exist from Team Life, by the way. He says especially in China, it's going to be picked up more. His long cooldown was his main problem, but now it's negative 40 seconds on level 1, which is going to be the big changer.
Yeah, it's definitely a big change. Like, the Aghanim chain, they buffed Brewmaster in like, the last version, the last patch. The Aghanim chain gave him like the Thunderclap and all his like standard spells on his ultimate. So he's already huge in teamfight. He was huge before. He was really picked at one point before TI3, or actually before TI2, but that's a long way to go. I don't want to go that back, that far back. But he's a really strong hero too. Like, he can basically crush. You just can't fight with some lineups. You just can't do anything when his ultimate is ready. And of course, the long cooldown. Like, people used to abuse that cooldown. So whenever he was CD on that cooldown, you could just get towers because he's completely useless when he has no ultimate. He just runs in, claps, and dies. Although he's quite tanky. So I mean, people just used to abuse that the same way they abused like RP Magnus RP being on cooldown or anything like this. Like, the 40 second change is a big one. And his Aghanim is huge and wasn't used because of opinion. It makes him even more viable and makes his previous...
Is Matt only lagging for me?
No,
he's in the last...
Just take a moment, Matt. Take a moment.
Take a deep breath, Matt.
Okay.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. And yeah. I think, like... It's one of those heroes where when you play competitively, you're like, you time the ultimate, and if you hear the ultimate is down, you can like successfully push a tower or force a team fight because you know Primal Split is down. Now, especially on the later stages of the game past 16, when it's a 100 second cooldown, you can never do that. Like, there's not going to be fights that you
Isn't his cooldown shorter with Aghanims anyway, and you will always have that on level 16, won't you?
Well, assuming it's a close game, hopefully.
Let me check. I don't remember exactly the cooldown with Ags. Damn it. Oh yeah, wait, was that removed? The cooldown thing? When he got his new ultimate? With Ags. I think it was.
I have no
recollection of what happened. But this was actually, I will really agree with this. This is, to me, one of the bigger changes to a single hero in the version.
This is so scary.
We have an abduction.
He drops, then Matt comes back, but not really.
Okay.
Do you see Ricky?
Yeah, I kind of think we've covered this for all the important points have been brought up. So I would like to move on because I have one or two heroes here that we haven't talked about yet
that I think are really cool.
I think Tinker is interesting, not necessarily because it makes a huge difference in competitive play, but because I'm not sure whether it makes a huge difference in competitive play. I want to hear you guys' opinions on it because I've been thinking about it a bit, and the way I'm interpreting the heat-seeking missile count doubled, I believe it can hit four targets once and not two targets twice. Is that correct?
That's how I interpret it as well. But
four targets once, yeah?
Yeah, I have
this. Pushing against this hero is going to be even more of a nightmare than it is
exactly.
Already.
This is weird to me because Tinker was already a good hero. Like, it needn't be buffed in my book. So this.
But
is
what item would you replace with Ags, though? That's the question. When would you get it?
You need the Blink Dagger or the Force Staff, for sure.
Yeah, like...
You have Blink Dagger, Force Staff, Scythe. Like, when do you fit it in?
No, you don't have to rely on the Scythe. Like,
yeah, that's the question. Does this replace the hex in the core Tinker build? Do you have enough mana with the Ags Scepter?
It's obviously a sort of a toss and feel kind of scenario where if you're behind, you're probably gonna go for the Scepter, and if you're leading, you're probably gonna go for the hex, where you wanna push your advances and just gank and disable.
I would love
the double laser cast range as well. By the way, it's 1100.
The pushing Tinker, the pushing side Tinker. You know, with the
that would work too.
With the march, like for example, the classic MYM, you know, Beastmaster Tinker pushing lineup, that works perfectly with the four missiles and the range of the ladder. You know, you can just like push back your enemy without any taking the fight, just harass them a lot and just get the towers because they just can't fight if they don't smoke behind or something like this. I would see this kind of Tinker with Agonist.
I like the approach where you wanna like buff Agonist Scepter on most everything you can and do like sort of cool spells and change the spells and so forth, but I don't know if Tinker was the hero to give a buff.
He doesn't need it, but it opens possibilities once again. Like this four hero targeting can be very, very annoying, to be honest. Like if Tinker has vision on you, it's impossible. It's so much damage. Like 4x300 damage or whatever it is, it's a lot. Like if he can rearm like once or twice, then the whole team is midlife and have to go back. It's really annoying.
Hey, Sin, just make a noise to me for a second.
Can you like poke your microphone real loud? Everyone, close your ears.
I muted and went to it. Maybe that helped.
Whatever you just did then, no, it's still there.
What's going on? It solved it the last time. I've had a friend of mine telling me this happens on Skype for some reason.
This is normally a Skype thing where your microphone will automatically adjust itself when you don't make sound. So it tries to get louder because it thinks you're talking quieter. So that's why I say go tools, options, sound settings, and if it has clicked automatically adjust microphone level, turn that off.
Oh, it should already be off, to be honest.
Should be.
Oh, I
turned it off. Was on for me.
Audio settings? Automatically adjust is off. It's really odd. I don't know.
Go
I hope
figure.
It's
just must be his headset.
Huh. Nah. I don't think so.
Oh, well. We just have you mute and unmute before you start talking. That's great.
Or maybe I just keep talking forever, so it doesn't adjust.
You could try that. you could run low on breath.
Think of the children.
Well, I can at least continue on the roll here, because I have, I think, one more hero, and I guess a lot of people want to hear about Faceless Void, but the hero I want to talk about first is Invoker, because we've seen Quasicsort pretty much completely take over. Nobody really plays Wex anymore, but now the Forge Spirits are getting nerfed pretty heavily. They lose their armor, or they lose two armor on all levels. They lose attack range, and the EMP gets buffed in two ways, and Alacrity loses 30 mana cost. So now you can start building Invoker with one point in Exort, points in Wex, and then as a Wex Quas Invoker on the lane, you can actually start blast hitting pretty freely without having to put many points into Exort, but just one point, and then use Alacrity, because 45 mana is nothing on the lane. So I'm curious about what you guys think about this, because this is how Invokers used to play. They would play with Quas for the cold snap, and then they would spam Alacrity in the lane for 50 mana back then, I think it was, and just outfarm their opponent. What do you think?
It's an interesting approach. Sorry, take it away, Matt.
No, it's fine. I was about to say the same. Like, I find it really interesting. I didn't think of it that way. But yeah, actually 45 mana, it's really easy to spam. Yeah, good points.
My biggest issue with this... What would you say? Would it be a buff or a nerf?
A burf.
A burf.
Overall to Invoker, or what do you mean?
Yeah, like... Alright, let this change for me. Like the EMP burn, I hate it. I hated that spell back when you would see nothing but tornado EMPs, and now to just give it such a huge buff, it's just like the most annoying spell in the game, and it's sort of it's counterproductive towards fighting. Like it makes the enemy team just be like, yeah, peace out.
Yeah.
What I like about this, I don't know if it's a buff or a nerf overall, but what I like about it is that it seems like there's more Invoker options, because the last time I saw a cross Wex Invoker, or just a Wex Invoker in general, in a competitive game was months ago. Nobody plays it, ever. So something needed to be changed to make Wex better, in a sense, but if this was the way to do it, I don't know. It probably wouldn't have been my suggestion, but I'm just happy to see anything that makes a hero that's so flexible have more than one skill build in competitive games, because let's be honest, every single player gets 4 points in Exort and Quas for the double Forge Spirits, and then they play with Midas and play this kind of pushing style. So I'm just really happy to see a hero with so much potential with so many different spells have more options. That's my point.
Considering the fact that Invoker was mainly played for his Forge Spirits, like the last few weeks, I think it's definitely a nerf, an attempt to make him, like, to get him, of course, to get Wex on him right now. In my opinion, it's a big nerf to Invoker. I think the best thing about Invoker was his ability to just kill tanks and push, speed push, actually.
I kind of have to bring something up right now.
We've got a new patch or a new update? Yeah.
Yeah.
What is it?
Phoenix has arrived.
Oh,
and may a tear be shed for the glory of our game.
We didn't even get to discuss Terrorblade.
No? No, we haven't discussed Terrorblade at all.
Let's wait on that, because we don't know how exactly he's going to work yet, do we? It just says what spells he has, but not exactly the damage values and the changes to him and everything. Because
yeah.
Phoenix has been patched a couple of times.
Phoenix has arrived.
I mean, I'm running by the assumption that it's the same as he is in Dota 1, right?
I hate this game. I hate this game now.
I hate this game.
We're still playing this.
He's such a broken hero.
Yeah, he is.
I don't feel sorry for the competitive scene. I feel sorry for the pub scene.
But the Phoenix,
because really, it's the pub scene that loses out in this.
The Phoenix you remember isn't the same Phoenix as the one you'll see. It's been patched two or three times in Dota 1 since we started playing Dota 2, I think.
Okay, so
it's a different hero.
Does that mean that Phoenix is balanced?
It's different. I don't know if it's balanced or not. I think, what was it people were super scared about coming into the game? I don't remember, was it Ember Spirit? That was like the most broken hero in Dota 1 of all time. He came into Dota 2, hasn't really been too big of a deal, to be honest. So I'm not really too worried about it.
I
just remember people telling me Ember Spirit was the biggest joke when he came in Dota 1. So our memories are not exactly how things are going to turn out in the end.
Well, I hope. I prefer not to lose my soul looking at this. But yeah.
Let's do Void really quickly. I want to hear what you guys think about it, because some people are making a really big deal out of it, and I'm not really sure where I stand. I think perhaps the biggest buff is actually the third one, but I want to hear what you guys think.
Bring you up.
About Void. Yeah. I don't know. I'm a bit mixed about it. The Chronosphere cooldown is huge. In my opinion, Chronosphere is a very underrated spell. I mean, of course, it's not when you pick Void. You usually pick him for this spell in particular, but it's the same. Like, we had the same discussion about Brewmaster. The fact that the cooldown is, you know, down to 80, you know, it's 20 seconds difference. I think it's, of course, it's not huge, but it's quite okay. The movement speed is also fine. I mean, 1k movement speed, that's funny, and it's going to allow him to position the way he wants and to basically kill anyone in the Chronosphere if he has a damage. So I guess it's a really interesting buff, but it doesn't change the problem of the hero once again. The laning phase, like, I'm always about that laning phase, but in competitive Dota it's so important. If you're gonna get
I mean, it comes down to whether or not you have a strategy where you can rely on getting to level 16 with him, basically, without already having lost the game. But once you do get to 16, that's where I feel like he's probably one of the strongest heroes in the game now, because an 80-second cooldown, that means that you don't ever have to be careful with your ultimate. The enemy isn't going to push you down just because you've used your ultimate, because it's going to be back up by the time they reach your base anyways.
You might even get two Chrono Fury in one fight. I mean, if you start open the fight, then start chasing and stuff like this, it might even happen. Two Chrono Fury in the same fight, and that's huge.
I think this is the most significant buff any hero has received in this patch.
It's really an important one for sure.
Yeah, once again, it's in a way, it's a little bit. I'm not gonna say it's exactly like the Enigma change, which is also, like we said, it makes him better at what he's good at, but he's still a kind of a greedy carry pick early on. He needs the supports to do a lot of work, and he's kind of limited in what he can do in the lane. That's why I think the time walk mana cost is also relevant, because with Void beforehand, you needed to be careful with your time walk because you couldn't use it that many times, and if you wanted to time walk into Chrono, kind of your entire mana pool was gone. So now he's a little more flexible in what he can do. So I really like that. But like Matt said, he still has the same problem in the lane, but when you get to mid-late game, if you get away with this greedy kind of pick, he's incredible now. And I will definitely agree with Maelk on that.
Yeah, and moving inside the bubble, I mean, in many cases, you waste half the Chronosphere of just walking to your target.
That's true.
Now you're practically there already, so I think it's an immense buff.
Yeah.
For me, the biggest buff overall, like of every hero, when I check the list, is the draw ranger. Like, I don't know how you feel about that hero, but I think it's the biggest.
See, I disagree entirely.
We were having a debate about this, but before in the office, because obviously, draw ranger, something changed with her. I must have an opinion, and sorry, people, it's going to happen. But it's always been the problem of draw ranger that she hasn't had a use. She's never had any kind of major use, and whenever someone came in close, she'd get pounded on and just destroyed. So kiting was basically what you had to do when just orb walking it out with the cold arrows. And now you've got something that can knock people back, and when you're like right in front, the max range is 350 knockback.
Yeah,
and you also get like we discussed this to us. It's not a mini stun. It's like the same effect as a four staff. Is what it does. And it gives you a silence on top of that one.
Yeah. Can cancel TPs, right?
No.
It can't cancel TPs. No, it's like four stuff.
Mm. Yeah, so that's a shame.
So why I hate this change, or not hate, I need to see it in action. It's one of those things where you can theorycraft a lot, but if you don't actually see what the meaning of it is, it's sort of hard to predict. But this assumes that you're getting people in on you and not you initiating it on them. Like, for instance, who doesn't go Shadowblade Draw Ranger in pub games, right? So if you Shadowblade in on an enemy and you want to silence him, you suddenly risk him being pushed away from you and the range of your attacks. So like, I'm not entirely sold on the idea. I completely agree with the vision of, oh god, Slark jumped in on me, I'll just silence him.
Yeah.
That's great. From a competitive standpoint, this is obviously...
I love how you used my example from before in the office discussion too. That's great.
I mean, competitively, this is probably very good for Drow, despite the slight radius nerf, but in public play, I'd be mad. I'd be fucking mad.
I think we're all gonna be.
See, I just want to say thank you to Ice Frog, because obviously he knows that my Drow Ranger set's coming out in about a month's time from now, so he knows when to bring the Drow back. He knows. He knows that it's her time again. TI4, Drow Ranger, most effective hero. Yeah,
and what about Beastmaster, guys? I'm seeing a double boar Beastmaster. How about that?
Wait, what?
Oh yeah, I was thinking about that too.
Checking
two
runes at the same time. How awesome is that? Without leaving your lane, keep on farming and check bottom rune and top rune. Like if I'm not mistaken, right? Like the Call of the Wild no longer destroys the previous summons. So
yeah, what's the cooldown on it?
You've got 60 seconds. It's been reduced. So it used to be 70, 80, 90. Now it's just a base 60. But what's the duration of the boar?
No. These are the durations. The durations are 60. Duration. What's the cooldown?
I think the cooldown is.
Check it. It's lower. Yeah, it's 30 seconds. If I'm not
25 wrong, seconds or something.
Yeah.
Checking. Exactly. Checking.
So you can basically have two boars. For 40 seconds. 40 seconds. So you can have two boars for 20 seconds, right?
Yeah, it's true.
It's how awesome is someone that? Someone come and Sucks stun two balls at once.
I could see that one coming, man. Come on. He's gonna shake them. We're gonna get winner, and he's gonna double shake on those.
Oh, yeah. No, I want to know, though, does the slow from the boss stack?
Stack, exactly. That was my question.
Wow, I would really hate life if that happened.
That is the best ganker, man.
Well, there were some slows that were recently changed, so they do stack, don't they?
I hope they do.
That's kind of true. Think about it. When does he gets the skill change, so you have the boar. When do you get the boar again? Because that got changed last patch.
Even better, guys. Double hook. Just imagine the vision before the teamfight.
Yeah, so on level 2. Okay, so imagine when you're level 3, in your mid lane, you can have two boars harassing the opponent hero. It's actually kind of strong for his laning play.
It's insane.
I was mainly thinking about just, you know, in fights and in pushing, that it's nice that you can put two boars in the tower, or you can put the boar in each enemy carry.
Someone's asking for a refresher so we can have triple boars.
That's one.
Yeah.
No, but it's actually quite good, and the double hawk is also
it's really good in the lane.
Pretty strong. Yeah.
I gotta say, this is another hero that I wasn't expecting to see a buff for.
Yeah.
I mean,
especially that buff.
Some could argue that it's not a buff because the duration decreases, making the hawk less viable because it still has the flight time and everything and can't follow the enemy around for as long.
Yeah, that's true.
But overall, I still think this is a buff.
Well, so now we look for Beastmaster and Brewmaster to meet back up in the middle lane.
I'm not sure the reason you would have to give him a buff was because you nerfed Necromicon. Like everything, knowing Ice Frog, everything has a consequence, right? So in nerfing something that is very commonly used by, for instance, Beastmaster, such as Necromicon, you would have to buff him elsewhere, and this may be one of those areas.
Yeah, it would make sense.
Yeah, it's true. Okay, so I don't know about you guys, I think pretty much most of the important things are covered. I don't know if we have like this agreement, a gentleman's agreement that we don't even want to talk about Earth Spirit, so we just leave him hanging, or
well,
I just move on.
I have a quote from Dendi on that one, actually.
Which one?
Okay. Let's hear it.
Where is it? Love all the changes on the most annoying heroes in the world. Broodmother and Earth Spirit. He's too Ember. I don't like easy ways. He basically said he never touched or played Earth Spirit because he just finds himself tainted by doing so. That was the only thing I really had to add to that.
He's right. Yeah. Props to him.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm really happy that they got the idea of swapping around the stun and silence, but I still need to see it in play. But I think it's a really intelligent change. But I guess there's other stuff to talk about because he's still not in CM anyway. But I have one last hero for you guys, and it's Tusk, which I think we've overlooked a little bit. What do you guys think? Because previously Tusk's crit, the ultimate crit, was based on the hero being under 50%. Now it just does the same amount of damage all the time. Which was met on the middle, so now it's 3.5 times his damage as a crit, regardless of the hit points. And Snowball now also stuns the secondary targets it hits, which I think is really good. I think this is a pretty big buff overall, and the only team we've seen playing it recently, in my knowledge, is Alliance. I think they're going to be happy about it. I think this is really cool, to be honest. And am I overestimating this, or what do you guys?
I don't think you are, because Misery, this was his big point. He thought Tusk was actually better before the patch, and now it's even better still. So Misery agrees with you at least, Sind.
I agree too. Denmark Unite.
Now you have to disagree, Matt, so we can get some sort of conflict going.
Actually, I have to agree. I like the hero a lot. We used it. We used it quite a lot actually in Sigma, like few weeks, maybe a few months ago. He's a really good hero to have. I'm still not sure about the overall potential of the hero. For example, we used him as a semi-utility hero, like a mech user, a force staff and stuff like this. Whereas I saw Alliance running him as a hard carry, or just a semi-carry, whatever, just like position one. I guess that buff goes to the way of the like the carry role, but yeah, I really like this buff actually on Tuskar. I think it will make him really stronger. Really good damage, really really huge damage on his ultimate.
Okay, one last mention that has been bugging me.
I got a lot of
sorry.
Heroes we can keep on bringing.
You got another one to bring up?
Oh yeah, I can continue all night.
Okay, yeah, we really could, but Maelk. Let me have two very quick comments, and then you can roll with whatever you've got.
Fire
is that
away,
cool?
Fire away.
All right. So, finally, Visage Birds are magic immune, because these birds have been the most random thing since Dota 2 started, when that hero came in. Like, what things worked, how they worked, everything about the birds was just ridiculous. And now it's been decided, okay, they're magic immune, great, now we know what they are. Yeah. And secondly, Hani, if Hani was here for this discussion, he would be talking about Windranger all the time, because he's wanted this change for more than a year, I think. Focus Fire has no cast animation, so now you don't need to draw your bow anymore, and the mana cost is significantly reduced, so now the ultimate is finally almost always worth skilling now, I think, or actually always, and is very useful to deal damage now when you hit a Shackle Shot, because previously it wouldn't really be worth it to start your ulti, but now it is. This small change means a lot, and the mana cost was way too high for what it did, so that's it for me, for the heroes. Okay.
Worthwhile pointing out, definitely. I hadn't even seen the Windranger change.
She'll always be Windrunner.
Yeah.
Yeah, she will. It's a really big change, actually, when you think about it. Like, the mana cost 150, that's the power shot mana cost for the ultimate. So, I mean, the cooldown is still pretty long if you don't have Aghanim, if I'm not mistaken, but maybe it's better. I mean, of course, this ultimate, I think, you know, it's very funny in Dota, like, almost all heroes are, you use the ultimate of every hero, and it's usually their principal, like, their best spell, almost. But this Windrunner or Windranger, it was always the case. The case, you would see people just killing stats instead of the ultimate, no matter what the position is. Like, I always wondered what was the point of that ultimate on that hero, you know, at least the way it's used by competitive players. Maybe the carry Windrunner is now viable, because you don't need mana pool anymore at all, like, or you need way, way less. Then you can go for damage items pretty early on.
Yeah. I want to bring out something trolly, just to get your trollish thoughts on this one. Yeah. I had a friend who may not be the brightest at Dota.
He's talking about himself.
This isn't one of those points where I have a friend who's got an issue. No, I know this person has an issue, and it's not me. But suggested Wraith King, or Skeleton King, Wraith King, and suggested that his chain should now just be very similar to basically what a Venomancer would do: jump in, suicide self after throwing an ultimate. In this case, the death from the ultimate was all he was thinking about.
But no.
No.
There's no damage involved.
No.
I would have loved to agree with your friend, but I have to disagree.
You confirm that your friend is indeed a little weird.
It's 75% slow for 5 seconds.
I mean, I can only see that Skeleton King, you know, just dying to a gank and dying again, and they're slowed, but they're still killing him, you know. Like, sure, they're slowed, but he dies again.
I'm just wondering what the logic is behind. I think Reincarnation has been buffed 3 versions in a row, and it's still not the point of the hero.
Still ass.
Still strange.
Yeah, doesn't make any sense to me, but I guess I just don't understand the hero yet. I really like the aura, though, but it's not buffed on Earth, so out of topic, I guess.
Yeah.
So, I have 3 topics to discuss. One, and the first one being Morphling.
Do you want to know something really crazy about the hero that you just picked? Can you imagine who I have a quote from for this hero?
Korok. Are we 2000?
No, you're both wrong.
Oh, who plays Morphling? Miracle?
No, it was actually from a similar region. I contacted HYHY and asked him what, out of everything you saw in the patch, what do you think is a good hero that will be coming in, or something along these lines? And he said Morphling. We should look to see Morphling appear again.
This is one of the biggest nerfs he got post TI2, and I'm happy he gets some love again. That's a big deal.
Yeah, so for people who don't know, you can see it on the screen, obviously. You can now cast and attack while in waveform.
It's interesting, but the biggest nerf, in my opinion, was, you know, not being able to morph fast enough. I guess, of course, it's important, but, you know, I still think he's way weaker than before TI3, but that's okay. I mean, he was really strong back then, so...
While he's also on the screen, too, I kind of want to bring this up for all the people who still believe. Meepo was also changed.
Not again.
It was changed again. So the Vita Wii stand level requirement is now lower still. It's now 3, 10, 17 is divided we stand. But what changes it, which is for me something which I thought was very unusual, is it passively reduces your revive timer. So when you hit level 17, you have 30% off your death timer. Now, is this just encouraging Meepo feed?
Yeah, who picks a hero to die?
That's, I really like your remark. It's actually more feed and more feed every patch. Like, I'm an awful Meepo player, really awful. But
I'm worse.
Every time it gets worse, man. Like, now I can feed level 3, and I'm gonna respawn faster. Like, my allies matchmaking are really not gonna be happy with that. You can tell them already, you know. Just.
I think the only real guy to ask about this at the moment would be No-Tail. And I think he said in the last version when Meepo's ultimate got changed, so it started on level 4, he thought it was a nerf because of the other changes the hero got, and they're still the same. It was something about the way Aghanim's works on the hero or something that...
He's already spoken on the matter. He said it wouldn't be viable competitively.
Yeah.
No. And he said he
used to push it through like 3 patches ago. He said it was okay to play, and then it got changed up, so then the stats didn't share, I believe it was. And then he said, now it's just pointless.
Yep.
And now, probably
true.
Even more pointless. What is more than pointless?
Oh, I mean, it's it's better now than it was, but...
This is better than last version, but it's still not good enough. That's the problem. Okay, Maelk, you had another hero, right?
Yeah,
before I go into items and what it means to heroes and so forth, Lesrak. The reason I bring this up is because I overheard people discussing, is this... Or why did they change Lesrak, and why is he nerfed? So I wanted to hear what Trolls and Sebastian had to say about that.
Mm.
Is it a nerf, guys? Is it a nerf?
I don't know. You know, Lesrak, it has always been the same problem. Only Smile, aka Afterart, has the answer for that. With NS, actually, with their really mixed builds on Lesrak, like, they get, like, sometimes they get stunned, sometimes they get a bit of three, you know, edict. My point is that the stun of Lesrak is one of the best stun in the game. Like, level 1, it's huge damage and really good duration. The edict is, of course, one of, like, I don't want to say which spell is the best, but edict is a huge spell, that's for sure. Everybody would agree on that. But, like, I mean, on the other side, you have to be tanky, right? So if you're going to get, like, lightning, edict, and stun, you basically want stats or, I don't know, maybe more items to be able to go in and use your ultimate. So it's one of the heroes where you never know how to build him. It's really situational. You have to adapt to how the game goes. So that's a big buff to the Lightning Storm. It's already a very, very, very strong spell. Now you can see that the cooldown is of 4. So you have 4 cooldown on the almost 300 damage spell. That can jump to 7 targets. So how huge is that? It's basically in a team fight. It's 1k damage every 4 seconds, almost. Like, of course,
exactly. I'm not an expert on people's opinion, but I couldn't see why they would think that this was a nerf. Because to me, it just seems like a huge buff. Like, you give up 5 damage to get 1.5 seconds off your cooldown and a pretty steep change in your mana cost.
Yeah, it's insane. In my opinion, it's a big buff once again, and it was buffed, I think. It's exactly like, it's funny because I mean it's not funny because it's, you know, there we just, in my opinion, revealed the spirit that's behind every patch. We're getting heroes stronger at what they're already strong at doing, you know, like it's what Sin did, what Sin said, sorry, a few minutes ago. So Lesrak, like, he still has the same problem. Can you afford to skill Lightning? Then you're not skilling Edict or the stun. But in my opinion, his third spell is a really strong one, especially for team fighting and farming as well.
Yeah, I think the way Ennis and Arsard generally skill him is that they get 2 points in Edict early on, so they can take the early towers, and then they just give up on the ability because it sucks in mid-late game. It's only really good for pushing and for early ganks. There's nothing else this ability really does. In late game team fights, there's too many targets and the damage is too low. But Lightning Storm, if you get a skill build like they do, where you get... I sometimes see them getting like 2-2-2. I think you said that as well, right?
Yeah.
And then you max stun on Lightning. This hero becomes incredible, especially for base defense, I think, and for tower defense. 4-second cooldown. What's the cast range again? I don't remember, but is it 600?
It's really good, and you can cast it on creeps, and it's going to go on heroes.
Exactly, because you can cast it on the first creep, and it's going to hit the heroes that are 300 range behind eventually. So I think this is
putting on the
really
middle lane
cool.
now, and thus getting a lot of level going up on him, and just having that
stamina
ability from the Lightning Storm, and then you can still max up Edict. and take down the spots. And you can't leave the lane because your wave is going to push faster than anything. Like, I don't see any hero clearing a wave as early as he does.
No, it's true. You can actually play him with 1 point and stun and just start putting extreme amounts of pressure. I didn't think of that. That's a good point.
Well, the potential of the it's one of the heroes where people play it in one way and he can be played in many other ways and with huge potential. So yeah, I want to see the Lightning Storm with left track. I think it's really strong, and honestly, early on, how do you want to take a team fight if you don't focus him and every second he is dealing?
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, it's up to you to do it because Trolls and I are no longer playing.
So. Bring it in.
He obviously doesn't seem to also be in the call anymore. Ah, there he is.
Man, it's so weird hearing Maelk say my name, because there's like no one in the competitive Dota scene who says my name correctly, or no one in the scene in general. And then when Maelk says my name, it's like, I remember where I'm from sometimes when that happens.
Are you talking about actually calling you Trolls, or calling you syndereN?
He pronounces both names the Danish way, which no one else does. So it's very weird for me to hear it.
It's Trolls and syndereN.
Yep. And nobody can reproduce any of those unless they're exactly Danish. Even Scandinavian won't work. Swedes can't pronounce it properly either. So, some people come close, though. And some people are really far from. Anyway, that's not really the point of the conversation.
All right, so you have one more thing, right? A lot of people have been talking about is obviously the change to Blink Dagger. And I think it's a huge change that allows strength heroes, especially like Initiators, Earthshaker being the first and foremost in receiving other buffs. Like move speed. Woo. So he's obviously better. You don't need the Arcane Boots per se anymore to actually be worthwhile.
Huh.
Are we alone now?
No. We have syndereN.
Oh, okay.
His camera's just lagged up and we've lost Mad. But hopefully he'll...
The camera's still wrong, or I can reset it if you want.
If you reset yours, we lose both cameras because we just lost Mad. But yeah. Go ahead and reset, man. Go ahead and reset.
All right, doesn't work. It's just war now. Yeah.
So what are we talking about?
Yes. So
Blink Dagger.
Blink Dagger and what it does for strength hero initiators. Like, obviously Earthshaker. We got Axe, a hero that we saw a lot of people simply skip the Blink Dagger build on him and go for like Force Staff or Mechanism if they ever picked Axe. I think Poppy and I were the only ones to ever do so. But now the Blink Dagger has no mana cost. He's actually viable again, alongside a lot of other heroes that would require a different item progression early on.
Yeah, the first thing I thought when I saw this item was Sand King, actually, who can now skip the Arcane Boots, which you would either get Arcane Boots or you would get a Bracer or two, so you had some tankability and some mana pool. But now it's actually possible to go for these kind of heroes with just flat-out regular Boots and Blink Dagger, and that pushes your impact a lot further, especially if you're playing it in a support role where it's hard to get that gold. I think it's really interesting, and Axe is perhaps an even better point than Sand King. I don't know why I didn't think of him, but he's like number one strength hero that has so much potential but has so many problems. The Blink Dagger change really favors him. So I definitely agree. I think this is, again, just like you said, this is for the strength heroes in particular. There's obviously a lot of intel heroes that get it, but they don't really share the problem. And I was wondering if this was too drastic of a change. What do you think? And do you think this is for the better or for the worse?
Oh, definitely for the better. I'm always of the opinion that if you can initiate and take fights and force fights, then it's for the better, because there's no change in the fact that you can't escape when you're damaged. So Blink Dagger doesn't really, like, having no mana cost, it's not going to change anything the other way around. Or in very few scenarios are you going to avoid fighting because of the Blink Dagger mana cost. So this will only add to fighting potential.
And another hero we forgot to mention, I think TC actually tweeted about this. He was like, wow, Slaughter doesn't need mana anymore. Because last patch, Sprint lost its mana cost. This patch, Blink Dagger lost its mana cost. So Slaughter has absolutely no mana problems anymore now.
But did he ever, like, I see a lot of people mention this, but did he ever have mana problems?
It was a hero I really enjoyed playing, and I felt like you often ran out of mana, because if you would use, like, Slithering Crush twice in a fight, which you obviously want to do, you'd be out of mana almost from that, and using Amplify once, you would be out of mana. Now it's actually, this is really interesting, I think, especially also because since you don't have to address your mana pool at all, you can build something else. It's really interesting on that hero, and Slaughter, by the way, got a little bit of a little buff as well on his bash damage. So, I'm hoping to see that hero more. I think it's really cool, and with the recent buffs he got, I think he can definitely be a choice again. But yeah, that's another strength hero that gets the buff. But it's really cool. I'm curious about this because I was a little skeptical if this was too much of a change, because I think it's one of the biggest changes to the game in general that we've had in a long time. Like you say, I think it's going to be for the better as well.
Yeah, basically every hero with like not enough mana pool and that's relevant when it comes to using bling dagger would benefit from it. Like or like you said, Axe, Lord, or even Venomancer, heroes like this.
Really
better.
Yeah, it's good on Veno too. That's right.
No. I want to bring up two things. One is the chat brought it up. I probably should do this first, considering we're talking about the blink dagger. But people are asking about Blink Bear.
I don't know about that.
Yeah, you don't need a point booster this time.
For what do you need the blink for?
Initiation out of range of a lone druid.
Yeah.
Way to do it. Yeah, but RK also wanted me to add to it because it's fun. But RK also wanted me to just bring in the fact that Enchantress is now finally getting some armor.
No.
She's losing armor.
Losing armor.
Reduced?
Yeah.
Ah, lol.
I don't like this change too much, to be honest. Enchantress has one problem right now. It's untouchable, in my opinion. It's very, very... I don't want to say broken, but it's a bit too strong, I think.
It should maybe have half effect on Roshan or something.
And I'm not even sure that if you hex, I think it still remains or something. Like, there's something wrong with this spell, in my opinion. Of course, the armor... I mean, in my... Like, the way I see it, when you reduce Enchantress... armor, then she's like less tanky against physical damage, but the problem is about untouchable, not really about the armor. That's the way I see it, at least.
Okay, I'm gonna ask a question. Couriers can't blink, right?
I was thinking the same. I was checking the, like, you know, the flying courier blinks with the pink dagger. I don't know what's going on with this, but I had this idea.
Yeah, I guess it could. Then it can give its blink dagger to its owner a little bit faster by blinking it towards him. That's cool. Yay.
Soon we'll be at the point when Dagons can be used again. We'll just have these blinking couriers with Dagons again.
Old Dota 1 days.
Yeah. The good days. I was actually talking to a couple of the guys who are making custom maps, and they're like, yeah, sure, we can give the couriers mana. We can have Dagon Wars again on top of the couriers. The old-fashioned way. Yeah.
That would be
okay.
Awesome.
I think out of all the items, there are perhaps, I think the biggest change, and I think this is also getting quite some attention, is actually that you can transfer wards. I don't know what you guys think about that, because this is something really new. You can buy a ward pack in the start, and then you can transfer a charge, like when you share a tango or a salve. So you can give the wards to an ally. It goes for sentries as well. I think this is a really cool change that opens up for a lot of different new strategies of playing the super early game. Because it doesn't have to be the support doing it alone. Now you can split them, give one ward to the offlane and one to the east lane, for example.
You know,
do you guys think this is overrated in how important it is?
No, but it seems so logical to me. Not like now reading it, I'm just wondering why
it was never done before.
Why didn't we have this 4 years ago?
Exactly. So it's definitely, I wouldn't say a needed change, but it should just be there. And I absolutely love it. Like the fact that you no longer have to stress around as the support early game and might miss out on positioning and stuff like that, and you can't really put an effort into ganking or anything. Now you can just give your offlaner the ward if he needs it, or your middle laner or whoever, and you can run to wherever you need to go. I think that's a big change.
Yeah, definitely. You know, when you used to run, for example, I don't know, for especially for the teams that runs double offlane, like double offlane, double safe lane, you emphasize a lot on both lanes and you need a ward, or maybe one ward on your safe lane, one on the offlane, and then it was really problematic. The positioning early on, like before the creep spawn, is really important in competitive matches, and that ward, not being able to give one ward but only two, was, I wouldn't say decisive, but it could cause some problems, so I'm really glad they changed it. Makes really good sense.
Toby wants to say something.
No. I was thinking something because I remember somebody sent me a message about something, but it's not what I thought it was.
Okay.
Yeah. I was looking at the Shadow Amulet and the fact you can now use it on allies.
Yeah.
And you thought it was a Shadow Blade.
Yeah. You guys think there's something behind it?
I think finally Shadow Amulet has some sort of usability. this item has been perhaps the worst item in Dota for a while. And the fact that you can use it on an ally is kind of cool. I mean, now it has some sort of interesting use to it. You wouldn't buy it for it, but at least this... Maybe now you won't always buy the Claymore first for your Shadow Blade.
It's
but
still a bit cloony, to be honest. Like,
yeah, it is.
I don't see one guy getting ganked and just, like, putting his teammates invisible or something.
Surprise!
I'm checking the changes, and I want to point out one, the branch 50 instead of 53, God, that's gonna make it easier to do the math early on.
Yay! Or,
like, what can I buy? I'm missing 3 gold. No more.
That's
of this.
True.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for that.
Yeah. That's very true.
Tools, I actually just now found out why we have the rain going on in the background.
Oh?
Oh.
Is it because it's raining?
Do you want to fess up, someone? Is someone cooking for you?
Huh? No, that's a long while ago. So it wasn't that sound.
Well,
no.
It's sort of gone, isn't it?
I don't know. I'm muting in between every time I talk, so it's perhaps because of that. So it doesn't change the volume.
But you had someone in the kitchen.
Yes. Someone. What do you think?
I don't know.
I don't
Your
know.
Mom milk.
Oh.
I don't know, man.
Okay.
Really? This was almost civil, this entire thing. Like,
yeah,
with our puppy, this talkDOTA has been the most civil it's ever been.
It's talkDOTA, so we had to have talkDOTA elements, right?
Anyone knows how is Goblack doing after the Necronomicon change, by the way? Is he depressed or what's going on? Any news?
Hmm?
How's Goblack doing after the Necronomicon change? I hope he's not too depressed.
What was he an abuser of Necronomicon?
Oh yeah.
Yes.
Of course he was.
Goblack abuses anything which he thinks is abusable. I remember one time I asked him, like, how do you drive? He's like, well, I just think of a hero which I really hate to play against and pick it. And then I pick 5 of those heroes. So then everyone, like, I know the enemy is playing up against heroes I hate playing against.
Like, actually, he's one of the, from the experience I had in the same team, like playing in the same team as him, he's one of the best at really, knowing which hero will be really favored, you know, after such, like, doing what we're doing right now. Which hero would be favored? You know, he sees potential before it happens. It's really interesting.
He was the man that called Treant before anybody else was going to grab it.
Yeah,
he's my favorite player. Oh, not favorite player, favorite captain. So, sorry, guys.
He has a lot of.
Well, they're both no captains anymore, so you're fine.
No,
he deserved it.
Now, who's captain of Sigma?
Well, you're technically still the captain, right? But it's Fata drafting or something.
Yeah,
are you guys doing it together?
Co-captaining, co-drafting, let's say. Fata is he's the official drafter of Sigma.
Yeah, okay. So that you can be called Iskma. That's good.
So the Germans are in control.
Yeah, but they deserve to be, honestly. He has great game understanding, great insights, so it's completely normal for me to step back.
Okay. I don't know. I think we're kind of reaching the end of the list, but I have... Let's see. I want to make a one point about the history, so we can backtrack this. Maelk, do you remember 4 years ago, and you too, Matt, but this is mainly for Maelk, because I think this is has been such a long path. How much damage did Radiance used to do per second? It was like 30 at some point? 35?
No, I think I actually think it was 60 originally. Then was changed.
Wasn't that just the flat damage?
And then was
Never mind. It says attack damage. Okay, I'm an idiot. I was thinking about the Radiance burn. Forget it.
Ah.
I'm just being stupid. Because I thought this was like the third or the fourth patch in a row that the burn gets buffed. But okay. It sounded absurd as well. 65 burn damage. What is it? It's 50 now, I think.
No, I think the burn damage is 60 as well.
Is it?
Isn't it?
Are you kidding me?
I would say a bit lower, but needs to be checked.
It's funny that none of us know for sure. Let me check. 50 damage. It's 50, yeah. I checked.
Oh, okay.
It. So, yeah.
60.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so never mind. It wasn't the burn damage. But Radiant's been buffed like 4 times in a row. It always gets a damage buff, some sort of buff. So, that's kind of funny.
Change, I'm not sure about like the 60 to 65. Obviously, not going to change anything. Or maybe I'm mistaken, but.
No. No, it was just fun to see Radiance getting these kind of buffs all the time. It's kind of like Darkseer, who got more cooldown in vacuum, and then he got more cooldown in vacuum, and then he got more cooldown in vacuum. It's like, yay! Four patches in a row.
There's a few of these buffs where it makes me wonder or think that Ice Rock is just doing it for promotional reasons, where people will be like, read the change log, then it sort of serves as an ad for the hero, and then they will start playing it. Because the change isn't really significant, But people will be like, oh, it's buffed, I gotta play it.
That's true.
Maybe, yeah.
That's how a lot of things actually work in this. And hopefully that works on the teleport scrolls as well, that people are like, wow, teleport got changed, maybe now I should carry a TP scroll. That would be great. What do you guys think about that? This is obviously a buff overall to defensive TPs, and the 50 distance change, does that matter on any of the towers? Can you now port into some sort of smart position with this extra 50 range? Nothing comes to mind for me, but maybe there's somewhere, maybe the top lane for Dire or something?
Mid tower? I don't know.
That does it get you into the river? Not from that range.
No. Some base TPs will get you out of base. Like Dire side had some spots.
That's true. Yeah.
So yeah, that's the.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that one. Maybe some, like, I know, for example, the Radiant Tier 1 bottom tower. Maybe you can like position better in the wood or something like this. But I don't think it's a major change. The stacking delay is interesting though. It can make a difference sometimes. I mean, yeah, it can make a difference. You win 1 second fight. Of course, it's really, you know, I'd say it's really not often that you can see more than 3 TPs, for example. I mean, it's really, really awkward situations, but I think it's okay. Like, I just remember the time where there was no stacking at all on TPs. You could all TP at the same time and, you know, you're ready to fight.
Luckily, that changed.
Yeah, for sure. Changed the game a lot.
Alright, so is there any last points anyone wants to have before we wrap this up?
Yay, Veil of Discord got buffed again.
Yeah, but like my assumption about that is that you need a visual effect, such as exactly like Pipeworks on Veil of, but a better one. So this would make the item viable, in my opinion. Right now, you don't really see. When was the item used, on who, and etc. So you can basically focus in on something like this.
That's a very valid point. Do you ever talk to IceFrog about these things? Because I feel like that's like it's a non-issue buff. Where there's no mechanical or technical side of it. It's just visuals.
It will change the item a lot. Because when you think about it, it's the opposite of pipe, more or less. And its pipe is still used, was very used at one point. No, it's not, but just for metagame reasons. And in my opinion, if you could see the effect of Veil of Discord on heroes, it would change a lot, and it would be used more.
It could basically have the same animation as Pipe just does, in purple.
Exactly.
Yeah. I don't think that would be a problem.
No, it's quite easy. I mean, I have no clue.
But what would you do then when they overlap? That's the problem. Because if you want to have a Pipe and a Veil on the same target, how do you make sure that both of them are properly visible? I don't know.
Did they some then? Orange.
Yeah, then they get another color.
No, I'm just, I don't.
And then when you use mech on top of them, they all get blue.
Does the, like, one question about the force tab, does it change anything? I'm not sure. You know, this is very, like, technique, I guess, like 0.4 to 0.3 turn time. Does it change anything, or any remark, guys?
Again, it's one of those things where, I don't know, I'm not
sure
as much into the Dota math that I can just imagine things before actually seeing it in action.
Yeah, I'm not sure about.
I'm wondering if there's something you used to be able to force staff away from because of the speed that you can't outrun anymore now, or something like that. Some sort of projectile that's faster, or some sort of combination of spells that you can't use so easily because you need that last 0.1 second. But nothing comes to mind for me.
No, me neither, to be honest.
All right. So I think it's time to bring this to a close. So last things. Pip social medias, boys. I know syndereN loves to do that. So where can people find you, syndereN? What are you up to these days?
Do I love to do that?
You love to do that, because every single time, like, you're like, oh, so we're going to reword talkDOTA. Oh, we're going to have Twitter tags. Twitter tags. Could be Twitter tags.
It would make a lot of sense to have the Twitter tags underneath the portraits so people know how to ask questions to us while the show is going on, so they can contact us there.
Next time, syndereN. Next time.
That would be a smart thing. It's okay, Toby. I suggested it 10 episodes ago and talked DOTA and never happened.
Yeah, that's why I say next time, syndereN.
No problem. Yeah, okay. I don't know if I want to promote too many things because I have quite a few things, but if you just check out my Twitter at syndereN_DOTA, and then you can find the other things via there. They're kind of cross-linked to each other, and I think it's kind of the same for you, Matt, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm having some back at us, but I think it's fine. No, yeah, it's DOTA on Twitter. And
Are you going to spell out your Twitter so people don't misspell it? He doesn't like us anymore, I think.
It's exactly the same as what's below his name. Just add DOTA on the end. Like below his name, below his face, which is currently paused. So yeah, that and DOTA on the end. And Maelk, you love using social networks.
Yep.
Don't leak as much as you used to these days.
I do not. So much more to leak, but now I can't.
So little time.
Yeah, I gotta be more responsible now.
Yeah. So if you don't already follow me, you're lost.
Nice one.
Oh, look who's back.
Yeah. I'd say the same thing, but TobiWan DOTA for all my shit. Yeah. The answer to am I still yes. Yes, you are. Anyway. Nice way to wrap up the show. So thanks for watching, everybody. If you missed all of the... If you literally just turned on the live stream and you're looking for the discussion, the VODs will be uploaded to YouTube later on this evening. And check back like an hour, maybe two, either on joindota.com or over at youtube.com/joindota. And we've got a couple of other things going up there too, including X Marks the News, so updates on weekly news stuff. TalkDOTA is meant to be a chat show, so that's exactly what we are. We leave Zoe to do the news with the X Marks the News stuff. And there's more interesting stuff coming up as well as far as YouTube series go. I know I cannot wait to get our custom game series up and running, and it's not far off actually getting there too. Project Manager, and a couple of other things also coming up, as well as our normal content being streamed out. And of course, the most recent one, which was announced, was MLG, which was announced earlier today, that we are now in partnership with MLG. So we'll be doing some fun stuff with them. VODs will also be available on the YouTube channel, as well as a couple of other places. So yeah, check all that kind of stuff out, as well as what we're doing. Always social networkers for all the people who are here, as well as joindota.com for everything DOTA. And thanks for watching Talk DOTA. It will come back properly, not just a special. It will be back in a year's time. I don't know. Anything is possible. Yeah. We'll see you guys next time.